ladies and gentlemen, now it is time to move ahead to our final panel discussion, a unique and powerful segment where the industry leader will share their journey and choices they make to decide between the competition and the brand. Could we have the logo, please? Ladies and gentlemen, we have our topic, Think Tank Marketing Reimagined. Also, before I call upon the panelists, I know we are a little off schedule, but we're trying our level best to continue with all our discussions, and we love the buzz in Mumbai. So thank you so much for sticking around and sharing, because we've got some amazing set of panelists who are coming up. Ladies and gentlemen, first up, we've got Subhayu Mishra, MD and Head Corporate Affairs, SEB, who has over 23 years of experience driving brand marketing communications and CSR for leading Indian and multinational brands in banking, capital markets, and financial services. In his previous role, Subhayu headed brand and corporate affairs at Barclays India and has handled similar roles in his career across channel marketing at Tata AIG. So ladies and gentlemen, a big, big round of applause for Subhayu Mishra. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us today as our panelists. Up next, we've got Varun Shridhar, CEO, Oppo Financial. The company is focused on providing financial services in India across payments, financing, and savings. Previously, Varun was working with PNB Paribas as the business development executive in Egypt, Paris, and other countries. His last role was with a board member in Sher Khan. Thank you so much, Varun, for joining us today. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, a huge, huge round of applause. Come on, we can give them a much bigger round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Up next, we've got Raghunandan Rao, Global Marketing Head, BOSCH Engineering and Business Solution. Well over 15 plus years of experience in multiple domains, has managed Japan office for 7 years for BOSCH Engineering and IT, and now working as a Global Head of Marketing for various products and services. So thank you so much, Raghunandan, for joining us today and being a part of the panel. Up next, we've got Ashok Ramchandran, President, Schindler, India and South Asia. Ashok is currently responsible for the operations, including that of the factory and the R&D facility. He's also been featured in the coveted list of 40 under 40 young business leaders of 2019 by the Economic Times. Highly passionate, motivated, and result-driven professional with varied experience from leading business and in mature markets. Thank you so much, Ashok, for taking our time and joining us today. And ladies and gentlemen, for our moderator, we've got with us Sandeep, who has been in the industry for over 30 years in sales and marketing, corporate communication, branding, and technology, Sandeep Ohri. He's also the co-founder and CEO of April Broadcast Private Limited, which is a six-year-old startup in the media tech space. Sandeep previously worked for the Rolta India Limited for over 10 years, a jury member at the DMA Asia Awards, a Rotarian with the Rotary Club of Bombay Sea Coast. He's somebody who's worked with and led corporates and startups and gained insights in what works and what doesn't. So thank you so much, Sandeep, for kindly agreeing to be the moderator. Everyone, a huge round of applause for Sandeep Ohri, who's going to be the moderator for today. So over to you, Sandeep.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, since we are running very, very late on time, what we've decided to do is, unlike the other panel discussions, we just took a call on this a little earlier. Instead of asking each of the panelists to answer the question, you know, we've decided some of the questions on today's theme, on this discussion theme, which is marketing reimagined. So what we're going to do is we'll throw up a few questions, and whichever panelist decides to answer it, and we'll try not to penalize any one of them specifically. Okay, so thank you very much for being on the panel today, and I know he has a flight to catch, so we will try and do this quickly. All day we've seen a lot of digital data and everyone talking about marketing and how digital is changing everything. What the question that I have to all of you is, the customer's digital journey doesn't seem to be ending. Do we already have enough data? Do we need more data? More data leads to more better experiences. I mean, where is this going to end and when? There is a mic that... Anyone, quickly.
Hi, it's very nice to be here, but I think after the earlier session, kind of tough to go last, right? I think very quickly, the world is changing. I work with a mobile company, and what we are trying to do is to reinvent financial services. Right, so we're trying to say our customers sometimes like to pay, other times like to borrow, sometimes they like to speculate, sometimes they like to invest, and sometimes after they've created some wealth, like to protect, right? So that's insurance, mutual funds, loans, et cetera, et cetera. The question, I think, what's changed in my mind from a marketing perspective is what I call contextual marketing. So very simply put, how many of you watched Sacred Games on Netflix? If you can do a quick, how many of you play PUBG? Maybe very few in this room, right? But I think if you were to apply for a personal loan tomorrow, and if you have seen Sacred Games ideally once, but if you're doing 3 hours of binging on Netflix, your personal loan pricing maybe is a bit higher because the risk is a bit different. But if you're doing very well on PUBG and you see Netflix, maybe you're a type of employee based out of a place like WeWork, or you're a type of customer who's different. So I think where the world is moving to is I see digital as an endless road, which necessarily is not going to stop. But we are going to start saying your insurance policy is lower priced, your personal loan is a higher priced or a lower priced, depending on what you see or do. And I think that's the big change which we see.
Somebody like to add to that?
Yeah, you're on.
Yeah, so I think I agree to what Varun was saying, and in a sense that when I was reading through this report, and one of the things that really kind of came out of that was, you know, almost 33% of people really think that there's not enough personalization of content and offers for them still. So there's a long route to go. 73% or thereabouts actually think that it's done well, but there's still a lot. But these 33% actually drop out. Because they think it's not good enough for them. So I think we still have a lot to go for. The second thing is about data in terms of, it's like network routers, okay? So it's data in terms of data is existing in various places across corporations, across bases, databases. It's important to connect this, provided the data security is taken care of and the risks are taken care of. And then you use tools under AI to make more sense out of it and hyper-personalize. So we all are still at data silo levels to an extent right now, but I think that's the direction forward. And if it's a shared sort of a resource, a good example of that is your CIBIL scores, right? Which was a shared resource and it came in and it suddenly really positively impacted the net sort of NPL levels in the retail consumer financial services industry. So there's still a lot of way to go. So there is no end to this journey, honestly, but what we need to be watchful about is disruptions that are happening. And that could make some players irrelevant. That could suddenly hit margins of certain corporations. So from a business standpoint, there's still one flag that's always up. But the journey is endless. Thanks.
So maybe I'll give a slightly different perspective, right? Because Bosch is a 135-year-old company. And if you can hear, yeah, we are a 135-year-old company. And for us, marketing was not such a big thing because a lot of things ran on patents, so we were anyway number one. And for a long time, if you don't know, in India we had like 98% market share, right? But now things are changing. Our customer base is changing. Earlier, and hence we were discussing, right? So we were earlier a B2B company, but now we are a B2B2C company, right? We have to think about how our customer is looking at technology. Earlier, we didn't have to think that, right? But now with all the Uberization in automotive industry, a lot of ride-sharing companies, electrification, stuff like that, it's the market is totally changed and your ground is moving drastically. And if I were to just give you a small statistic, right? A normal car, right, has about 1,200 parts, 1,200. An electric car will have 200 parts,
oh,
right? And there is no complication of emission, there's no complication of efficiency. All you have to do is just put a efficient battery management system, it transmits power and you run it, that's it. Right, and then you have a nice looking iPad like in the Tesla, and you know, you do all that. So for us, actually, the digitization is starting now in marketing, because now we have to not communicate with the OEMs like the Suzuki's and the Hondas, but we have to now communicate to the end customer, which was not happening with us earlier at all. So it's for us, the whole scenario has just changed in the last 5 years.
So it doesn't seem to be ending anytime soon. That's the consensus. Okay, moving on to the next one. See, with so much of data being now available and so many people now figuring out that, you know, that so much of data is available. So digital seems to be now leveling the playing field. So what does that mean for the brands? Do they need to focus their efforts on competition or the customer?
If I can take that. I have a very simplistic view on this. I think end of the day, every company is trying to create value for customers and deliver superior service. So a lot of times when you go towards this, the basics are missed. And most times, just by getting the basics right, itself will create value for customers. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I think this whole confusion of trying to innovate, trying to be different, I mean, basic things don't work. And what is the point in doing that? I mean, you know, I come from an industry which is somewhere, you know, you get, it's a captive market. You know, when you buy an elevator with the lift company, most customers have to live with that lift company. And whilst we are trying to be innovative with digitization and stuff, if you don't do basic maintenance, your lift is going to break down. Yeah. And I have a very simplistic view, because simple things are more difficult to be done, I think. And people are complicating things much more than that. That's my view.
So, in your opinion, one should not really focus more about, you know, what the other guy is doing and just continue to do what's best for their customers?
Absolutely.
Yeah, so I think I agree with that. And the sort of thing is, you know, if you look at the pure plays, okay, you take email service, you know, once upon a time, Hotmail was the place to go to, then it became Gmail. Similarly for search engines, similarly for anything. So even inside a technology pure play, you still have people getting redundant or obsolete, right? So it's not about that you are in a legacy business and there is technology happening and the technology is going to wipe you out. That's not the point. And hence the competition coming out basis that technology is going to wipe you out. It's your relationship with the customer, the experience that you provide, and you're back to basics on that side. So it's not as if there is a thing happening in legacy companies which is inherently putting them at a disadvantage. The important thing that's happened to my mind is that the technology is now forcing you to actually think and break stereotypes. Otherwise, you'd be doing something which you're doing for the last 300 years and there is no conversation around it. So at some level, I think the basics of staying close to the customer, having customer centricity, and being nimble to sort of any change that's happening in the market or in terms of anticipating what a latent need could be are more important than actually indexing you yourself to the customer, to the competition.
Yes, which is interesting, which actually brings us to the next question that I had. What's the best way for brands to keep up in this fast-changing scenario? I mean, what would you do, for instance? And your market is very different from his. So what would you as a brand want to do, and how would that be different from them?
Maybe I'll take that question, because we have this conversation almost every day now, right? So the tagline for Bosch is invented for life. And I have the senior vice president in my company who speaks about innovation. And he says how being innovative is just not enough, but you also have to have empathy with innovation. And hence Bosch has this tagline of invented for life, that whatever we do, it has to ultimately create value for customer.
Okay.
And it has to impact his life. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, your innovation is going to die down over a period of time. And the reason why we've been a 135-year-old company is that every product that we've built, it ultimately affects the life positively to the end customer.
Okay.
And I think that's going to be the key. Digital marketing, of course, is to communicate that, but the key to stay alive is that, I think.
So, it's, yeah, sure, go ahead.
Maybe
couple of comments. I fully agree with him. I think you'll have to solve a problem to succeed, right? What's changed, however, is as follows, and I'll go back to a question that you asked earlier. Data now is actually become available only to a few people. Okay. What's happened is large companies like Google, like we were discussing earlier, has drawn a circle around the earth. It's called Google Maps, Google Search, Google Pay, or whatever you may want to call it. So if you want to access the world, you actually have to pay somebody for the data. So data is no longer available to everybody. It's available to a very select few. Mm-hmm. That's causing competitive disadvantage or advantage, right? So for example, you have to solve a problem. Going back, I think Bosch solves many problems every day, right? And I think if you're not able to solve, now what's changed in the digital world is you solve problems on the fly. So you don't wait, you don't have an R&D lab. So for example, I was with somebody in a very famous e-commerce company. They have something called web labs, right? So at any given moment on a page when you're buying a phone from them, you're running about 16 web labs, which means 16 different screens being shown to about a million customers. Their product, which is to offer them a journey to buy a phone with a finance option, is done 16 times differently. Within 6 hours, they decide which is the final screen, and then that's uploaded during Diwali. Now, I think product innovation marketing has changed. So you're trying to solve a problem, but you're doing it digitally on the fly. Your product cycle now is no longer 3 years or 3 months. I think you're down to 3 to 8 hours. Wow. Because while you're simple and you have to solve things simply, I think you have to be very, very fast on your feet. So it's like a dancing elephant.
It works for, like, you know, products which are more digital in nature. But for them, you know, the products are more engineering in nature. How would you handle something like that?
Actually, everything is digital nowadays. Believe me. So Bosch has a target by 2020. All the products that we manufacture will have an IP address.
Okay.
All.
Wow.
Right. And I don't know if you know, but we no longer just manufacture cars. We are the guys who half the sensors that are manufactured in the world, which are on your mobile phones. You know, when you turn your phone, your picture shifts. That's because of a sensor in your phone, and that's manufactured by Bosch. Right?
Okay.
And so I don't think we can escape from digital, literally.
I would agree with the same as well. You know, even for us, which is a very traditional, you know, kind of industry, it has taken over, absolutely. And it will remain very basic, probably only in a very few segments, but predominantly it's moving towards something else. And the funny thing is now we're not even competing with elevator companies. We're competing with non-elevator companies, you know, a Schneider or a Honeywell, or like we were talking about something Bosch was doing as well. So it could be different, and then all of a sudden, if you're not doing it, we won't be there. Right. So you have to be there.
Yeah. So which comes to the issue that when considering for any type of company, for instance, considering what should be their budget allocation for, you know, digital expenditure, what, in your opinion, going forward would be, you know, and this I would request each of you to answer for your own industries, what would be the let's say, not the one key, but the two key metrics that you would want to look at when deciding, you know, the where should we spend our money and what should we keep track of? We can start with you.
Yeah, so it's a bit of a hit and miss in the banking side of it. I'm not too sure that the science is still sort of perfect enough. But I think in terms of understanding, one is we look at sort of the returns on investment on a classical sort of marketing exercise. Mm-hmm. Then we look at the sort of efficacies of certain kind of channels. Then we do a little bit of trials around these. And then we focus. So I would say around in a budget, it would be today we are currently pegged at around 35-40%, but this is only growing. There are certain advantages of a conventional media. For example, print still has its sort of, you know, stickiness about what you're doing, and a certain kind of advertising goes into print. Television has more emotive content, but that's slowly shifting in, but television still holds it. So today, it's about a 35% what banks are doing right now, financial services more or less. But if you go to the new age sort of companies like NBFCs, et cetera, it could, my suspicion is it's a bit more than that. So that's where we are.
So you come in the new age.
Yeah, he passed on correctly. I think from our perspective about, and let's define what is digital spend, because maybe there are too many definitions.
Okay.
So I think anything related to IT people, so technology people, technology investments, digital marketing, et cetera, should be considered in my mind tech/digital spend. I call myself a tech fin. My company does a great job of making cameras. Right? That's our core competency. So now we are entering financial services. We spend anywhere from 70 to 85% of our budget on technology-related spends. I see two KPIs for that. First is what we call client engagement. How many times does a client meaningfully engage positively with you? So for a financial services business, that could mean how many times he's watched a TikTok video about you training him or her on mutual funds.
Okay.
Right? I think that's where the world has shifted to, which most new age companies, it's reality. For many others, it's something cool to stay on stage, right? So I think that's what we call user engagement. I think the second thing I love about traditional companies is the ability to make money. I'm from a banking background. If you don't make money, you don't pay salaries. There are families, there are lives behind. You have to be conscious about that. So that's the second metric. There's a third metric, which I think is super important these days, is how much you spend on data privacy.
Interesting.
I think people like us who are owning data have to be responsible. So we have to proactively spend money on data privacy, data security, data education. So we almost spend about, or plan to spend about 15-20% of our total spend on that. Because with time, that is my competitive advantage or disadvantage.
And that's over and above how much you spend for the technology that you said?
It's all inclusive in my 70-80%.
Oh, that's it.
The rest 20 maybe is once in a while a newspaper ad to say that I've changed my name, like a government gazette. Otherwise, print media doesn't make sense, or TV or any of those.
Sure.
In our industry being still quite traditional, but I would say the innovation spend focused on safety quality, key. But then the second most important thing that we have done is the people part. So if whilst you have the technology and innovation, you need to make sure that you have the right people who can be being part of the R&D, being part of the manufacturing, being part of operation, so that they can create the value that the customer needs to be seen. So it would be these two.
Okay. What about you, Raghu?
So maybe I'll answer it purely from a marketing spend perspective, right? Because I know there's a lot of audience who's interested in this. So from the, I took over marketing about 3 years ago. And from that time to now, how it's changed is nearly 60% of our business, considering that we have products which have the touch and feel. It used to be mostly exhibitions, and, you know, a lot of stuff like that. 60%. When I took over, that's what it was. There are three major things that have taken over the budget in the last 3 years. Number one being digital, right? So we spend a lot on digital media. And when I say digital for us, since we are B2B business, we do a lot on LinkedIn, because I didn't hear a lot of LinkedIn here today in the whole day. And LinkedIn for B2B is quite big in terms of mind share and stuff like that. Somebody is yet to convince me that Facebook, Twitter, and all gives you leads. If somebody has strategy, they can tell me. Second one is content. We've moved, because we have to communicate with that end customer. Content for us has become key. So the second thing that has taken over is content. The third one is experience. We have now a separate budget allocated for customer experience. That never existed earlier. And that experience, so we have specialized partners who create only experience now.
Okay.
Earlier, this didn't exist at all. So three major things, I think.
Okay. Since all four of you are from very, very large companies, and you know a large part of our economy is also driven by the MSMEs and the startups that are coming, what would be your advice to the MSMEs and startups who don't have such deep pockets? And as you mentioned, they also don't probably have access to the data because of not having such deep pockets. So in your opinion, what would be the best go-to-market for in digital for such MSMEs and startups?
I would in fact say that the times of big spending is gone. You know, I don't think you really have to need, you know, have to have a Shah Rukh, for example, endorsing. I think there was just a recent article a few days ago, right? At Vicky Kaushal and Ayushman Khurana are now the, you know, much lesser expensive, L'Oreal to millennials and stuff. I mean, he actually nailed it, you know, social media. I mean, LinkedIn, you don't have to spend any money, in fact. You can have good social media experts in the organization who are not very expensive, and you can manage it on your own as well. You know, it's very funny because Schindler India has the second highest number of LinkedIn followers right after Schindler Group worldwide. Okay. So we are bigger than Schindler US, Schindler China, which are much bigger organizations than Schindler India. And I just have one person and they have big teams. So it's as simple as that, you know. So I think we don't have to complicate it at all, in fact.
Okay.
You know, I'll give you an example of a company called Zerodha. I don't know how many of you know them, but they're India's number one broker now. They beat me personally black and blue for the last 3 years when I was working at Sheikh Khan. So I have a lot of respect having lost a battle for Nitin Kamath, who runs that company. So 10 years back, he started. He has not spent one rupee on advertising and has made Zerodha the number one company in India. You know, I'll go back to what both of them said. I think he kept it very simple. He said, I will deliver outstanding products. Outstanding service. I will solve a problem for a user. And if he's able to do that, I think there's so many other great examples in India of having leveraged what we call PR, or in the digital marketing world, ORM or online reputation management or social media influencers and so on and so forth. But you know, I think he's just run a company beautifully, and today it's worth at least an important amount of money and is by far number one in India, beating ICICI, HDFC, and Sher Khan, all three put together. And I think that's a great story. So please don't spend if you're an SME. You know, please don't pay any TV agency, any print, any media guy, any brand agency. It's all wastage of money.
I'm not sure they might like to hear
Sorry.
All of this.
No, I have a slightly more,
live, incidentally.
Slightly more moderate view. Zerodha is a great example in sort of the industry that we come from. But I think it's an opportunity than a challenge, because you have a lot more measurability of what you're doing, and hence you can actually run pilots and see those efficiencies and then target, craft out your advertising and communications and marketing plan, which wasn't the case in conventional media, because if you put out a front page ad in Times of India Solus, it disappeared in just 24 hours, and you didn't know what exactly happened to your money. So today you have all kinds of matrices we are all familiar with, so I'm not getting into that. That's one part. The second part is this: the reputation, which he referred to, it has a downside, but also if you work it well, if you leverage it well, there's got tremendous upside without spending money. So you could pay through influencer outreach programs, etc. You could also do great work and see that reflect on your social media conversations. So it's opened up and it's made life actually easier. It's exactly like in business, right? You know, you have got smaller players who have come and just through the internet created a market, you know, attended or got into a marketplace and participated and are successful. And marketing follows pretty much the same thing. So yeah, it's been easier actually.
So about a month ago, we had our CEO come to India and we had organized this interaction between startups in NASCOM 10,000 startups, and there are about 25 startups, and all in the automotive space. And I think they had asked a similar question, you know, what should we focus on? And I think his answer was very clear, and I think I resonate with that, is you have to focus on your customer. If you're solving the most painful problems of your customer, usually the product sells for itself. And then you're not selling the product, but only creating awareness about your product. So as long as, like my first point, as long as solving a problem, I think it's more or less done. 50% of the job is done there.
So despite everything and all the fluff, we still need to stick to the basics. Yeah, but the flip side also is that a lot of the you know, MSMEs and startups, they're so busy doing what they're doing, they really don't, you know, have the wherewithal to do and to figure out the rest of the stuff. Now, it's very easy for us to, you know, sit here and say this, but if the people who are actually out there busy, you know, doing what they're doing best and they don't really know.
But I really don't agree with that, right?
Okay.
And there are a lot of people who ask this question, you know, why is this, why is this guy coming and advising us? We hear that a lot of times, but if I can give you statistics of Bosch in India at least, right?
Sure.
Maybe you would agree. The average age of my company is 26, right? Compared to Germany, where it is 48 or 49, right? And we were talking, the average age in Vietnam, Bosch is 24. Right, so we are as young, and my company still creates products grounds up with proper budgeting, which means if your idea doesn't go through, it doesn't go. Right, you're given as strict budgets as anybody else. So I think it's possible.
Yeah. Okay. So since our topic is in terms of what we can reimagine. If I were to ask you, what's the one wild idea that you think is going to happen in the next few years? And then we can always come back and, watch this video again and then, figure out who had the right idea. So if I would ask each of you, what's the one wild idea that you think is going to happen in the next, let's say, 3 years? What would that be?
It's pretty scary to think of this, honestly. I hope technology doesn't get into our minds to sort of read what we are thinking at the moment. Beyond that, I think it's reached every room of our house. But yeah, that's the wildest thing. I mean, mapping the human mind.
Mapping the human mind.
Yeah.
Okay, great. What about you?
I would love to see Google Bank.
Google Bank.
Yeah, so we were talking earlier, UPI last month, 1.15 billion transactions, 46% of India. Google Pay has a market share of 37%. Phone Pay owned by Flipkart is 35%. I would love to see, even though Google is my competition, a Google Bank having a 35-40% market share in India, and all of us actually, the Uber driver buying one paisa stock. So financial inclusion for the next 500 million Indians can only happen if a Google Bank or a Phone Pay Bank or a Paytm Bank, or hopefully tomorrow somebody like us. But I think that would be the a 3-year disruptive idea.
Cool.
Being an optimist or a wild idea, I don't know, but I would really hope that Mumbai really becomes a Shanghai. Mumbai to become a Shanghai,
That's a really wild idea.
That's really wild.
So hopefully in 3 years we'll have more subsidies for electric, and then the adoption is much higher, because with the current levels I don't think it can happen, and I think the technology will get much better, the storage technology and this one will get much better. But from on a lighter note, right, from a marketing perspective, I think the sales guys are going to get more lazy because of digital marketing. But I don't think that will be the answer. Still, the traditional techniques of sales will sustain.
Okay, great. So, that's all that we have for today. And I'd really like to thank all four of you. And please, a big round of applause for all of them. It's not easy being the last session and standing between, right now and everything else. So I thank you very much for all of you, and I know you have a flight to catch.
Not easy for them also, actually. They're sitting at 8 o'clock. Thanks a lot for that.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, a huge, huge round of applause. And may I request Ketan Lakhani, Managing Director, Orienta, to kindly join us on stage and felicitate our lovely panelists. Ladies and gentlemen, let the claps keep roaring as this is the final panel discussion concluding TAVF 2019 out here. Thank you so much, gentlemen. Request you to kindly come ahead towards the hashtag, and if you may just step a little ahead and allow our team to clear the setup at the back. And Ketan, if you would request you to kindly give away the mementos one by one to all our panelists. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. Let the claps keep roaring. Thank you so much for being a part of this incredible panel. Ladies and gentlemen, let the claps continue in this atmosphere of TAVF 2019, adding to the glitterati, which is going to be following the panel discussion. And once all our panelists are felicitated, we request you all to join us as a group as well. And of course, thank you so much for moderating, ladies and gentlemen. Requesting you all to kindly come as a group together, as this is the tradition and this is the hashtag TAVF 2019 moment. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the final panel discussion, and what an incredible panel discussion this has been. Thank you once again for joining us. Thank you so much. So ladies and gentlemen, now it is time that we've had a great learning.